Good afternoon, all. The title of the case is Endovascular Flow Diversion of Complex Basilar Artery Fenestration Aneurysm. Coming to the history and examination, she was a 46-year-old female with history of intermittent headache and vomiting, which was there for 6 months. So for which she had underwent an MRI in the private in December 2018. So the MRI was showing some aneurysm in the basilar artery. So she didn't have any weakness, tinnitus or a seizure or diplopia. She came to us, our OPD, in January 2019. So at that time, her neurological examination was completely unremarkable except for the symptoms. So this was the images of MRI she was carrying, and we also did MRI in AIMS. So these are the axial T2 sections of the brain at the level of medulla. This is the upper medulla and this is the cerebellum. In front of the medulla, we can see a T2 hypointense lesion. So better appreciated in this section, we can see this is the T2 hypointense lesion. It is, we call as a flow wart. So it is located exactly in the position of the basilar artery. So this is an aneurysm. So on the sagittal images, you can see this is causing mass effect at the level of pontomedullary junction. This is the pons and this is the medulla. So it is causing mass effect and it is not thrombosis, it is completely patent. So these are the angiographic images. Here you can see these are the two vertebral arteries. This is the right vertebral artery, left vertebral artery, and at the site where they meet, we can see this aneurysm. We went ahead and did a DSA, a cerebral angiogram, on January 3rd. So this is the right vertebral angiogram, AP view, lateral view, and this is the left vertebral angiogram. So in right vertebral angiogram, what we see, this is the V3 and V4 segment of the vertebral artery. So this is the basilar artery and these are these two posterior cerebral arteries. So we can see here, this is the aneurysm which is located in the proximal part of the basilar artery. So the same is in the lateral view. Here we can see this is the aneurysm. You can see in the posterior aspect it's somewhat triangular. So probably this is the weak point of the aneurysm. If it ruptures, most likely to rupture from the posterior part. So when we see, this is the left side run. Here we can see this is same, the aneurysm is filling, the basilar artery is filling and the posterior circulation filling. What we notice here is that this is the normal course of the vertebral artery on the left side, but on the right side it is somewhat abnormal. So we also made a note of it. This is the abnormal course of vertebral artery also. So these are the 3D reconstructed images of the aneurysm. Here we can see this is the right, taken from the right vertebral artery run. This is the right vertebral artery and this is the aneurysm. When we clearly notice here that associated with this aneurysm, we have two limbs. Normally, we see a basilar artery like this, a single channel. So we are looking at it, we can see here two limbs of the aneurysm. This is called fenestration. So normally, popularly called fenestration in the literature. The same in the lateral view. We can see the big size aneurysm measuring 17 into 19 mm. So, and this is the posterior aspect. You can see some triangular kind of outpoaching. This is more prone to rupture. This is the simple diagrammatic representation of what we are seeing in an AP view. Here we can see this is the right vertebral artery, this is the left vertebral artery. Both are meeting at the vertebrobasilar junction, and instead of seeing a normal basilar artery like a single channel, we are doing two limbs. This is called fenestration. This is the right limb of the fenestration, this is the left limb of the fenestration. The aneurysm is located in between. And these are the CT images where we can see a completely filling aneurysm. So now the diagnosis, complete diagnosis here is a segmental non-fusion or a fenestration. See, like there is some embryological mishap in this. So fenestration is very popularly used. So this is fenestration of the proximal basilar artery with associated wide neck aneurysm. So we have an aneurysm associated with fenestration. Then what is the plan here? So now coming to this, we have two options, surgery and endovascular. So in surgery, looking the critical location, it is located to the anterior to the brainstem. So when you go into operate it, there will be lot of risk. So endovascular treatment is preferred in these cases. So what are the endovascular options available in this? So when we look at the endovascular options, see, the two most commonly performed things are simple coiling and balloon assisted coiling. So whether it is applicable in this case, we'll see. See, this aneurysm is very big, as I have told, 17 into 19 mm, and it is compressing the brainstem. It's almost abutting the brainstem. And when you look at these two limbs of the fenestration, they are involved by this aneurysm. If you go and put the coil in this aneurysm, it will occlude both limbs of the fenestration, it will occlude the basilar artery. And it will, if you put a coil in this big aneurysm, it will going to compress the brainstem also. There are two hurdles in this. So this simple coiling and balloon assisted coiling are out of options. Then what we have? We have a stent assisted coiling. How can we place a stent here? We can place a one stent from, so it's ulta here. So left vertebral to left to the basilar across the left limb, right vertebrae to this fenestration across the right limbs. After this, what we have to do? Still we have to put a coil. So stent plus coil is an option also, but we don't want to, you never wanted to put a coil in this because of the mast effect. Then what we have left with is, this is the flow diversion technique, so which is recently coming to the picture. So this is usually done by putting a flow diverters. Flow diverters are mean but a stent. They're similar to endovascular stents, but they have advanced design and delivery technique. So when you put them in this artery like this, what they do is that they divert the flow from the aneurysm into the parent artery so that the aneurysm will thrombose. This is how the flow diverter works. So now we thought of doing this. Then considering this type of aneurysms are very rare and experience with a flow diverter in these cases are very limited, then we thought to review the literature how best we can do this case. So when you look at the literature, we had only 4 cases available in the literature which this type of aneurysms are managed with the flow diverters. So what are the, how they manage this? So to understand this, just we have to just look at the hemodynamics of this. So when you see here, we have a left vertebral artery and right vertebral artery, and we have 2 fenestrations aneurysm here. What happens here is that when you take a right vertebral artery, we have 3 arterial jets coming from below. One will go to aneurysm, one will go to right vertebral artery, one will go to left vertebral artery. Same here from the right. So we have a 6 jets converging at the basilar bifurcation, filling the aneurysm. What we have to do is that we have to eliminate the jet into this aneurysm from right and left, both sides we have to eliminate. So how this best possible? So these are the 3 techniques which have been described in the literature. 1, we have to put a flow diverter from right side into the, sorry, left side from the left limb of the aneurysm, then occlude the right vertebral artery as well as the aneurysm. So that what happens? Out of 6 jets, we will have only 1 jet from left vertebral to left basilar to left limb to basilar, so that aneurysm will be evaluated, excluded. And the second 2 options are like this. You put a flow diverting stent from the left vertebral artery to left limb, or a same with extension into basilar artery. These are 2 other techniques which are described. So now coming to the our case, we didn't want to occlude the aneurysm because of the mass effect with the coils. Then we excluded this. Then we tried with, we thinking of doing these 2. Then it comes to the cost of this. We're putting a flow diverter, 2 flow diverters, it will double the cost. So we consider the cost option also. Then we thought of doing with a single flow diverter. How can best we do this? So then we tried with this new technique. So this was the first time. So we didn't find any literature regarding this. We tried this. So what we planned, what we thought was that we put a flow diverter from right vertebral artery across the VB junction through the left limb into the basilar artery. So that what will happen? The 3 jets from the left side will be completely abolished, and everything from the right will go through the left limb of the fenestration to basilar. So we are converting this 6 jets into single jet, so that everything will get everything aneurysm and everything will get occluded. So this was our plan. So we entered with this procedure. So the patient was started on dual antiplatelets 3 days before the procedure, and procedure was performed under general anesthesia. So we accessed both common femoral arteries and we placed the girder in the both vertebral arteries. So this is the microcatheter which has been taken from the right limb of the vertebral artery, and we entered the left limb and it's placed in the right posterior cerebral artery. The same is in the lateral view, and we can notice here, as I've already told, in the posterior aspect there is a dangerous kind of a lobule in the aneurysm which is very prone to rupture also. So considering this, what we thought was, in case of any untoward mishap, because if it might ruptures, because patient is already an antiplatelet also, we thought of placing a microcatheter in this lobule of the aneurysm, so that if anything happens we can occlude this aneurysm also. That was our plan. The same is here in the left. So this is the microcatheter in the lobule. Then we started deploying the flow diverter from distal to proximal fashion, which I have told, from the proximal mid basilar artery across the left limb of the fenestration towards the right vertebral artery. So this was the pipeline. The flow diverter used was a pipeline clicks, which is the most well studied device in the literature. So this is how we place the flow diverter from the basilar artery across the left limb of the fenestration and towards the right vertebral artery. So we didn't touch aneurysm or the right limb of the fenestration. These are all the runs after putting the flow diverter. So you can see this is the right vertebral run. We can see still aneurysm is filling all the branches of the basilar artery and posterior circulation are filling. This is the AP view and this is the lateral view. So we can see in lateral view, the most anterior part of the aneurysm is not filling. That means the flow in the aneurysm has slowed down in this case. Then this is the delayed images of this lateral plane. You can see some contrast here. This is in the pseudo lobule, the lobule of the aneurysm. So there is a stasis. That means there is some stagnation happening in the aneurysm. And same in the left vertebral run. So we can see filling aneurysm and all other branches. So these are the DynaCT images. So we can see how the well-placed stent, but you can see some narrowing in the stent here because the segment of the artery is small here. So device didn't expand completely. In normal arteries, we tend to use a balloon to expand the stent, but this is a dysplastic artery. So we don't use any balloon in these cases. We left it as that. And this is in the lateral view. And this is the post-procedural CT. We can see a well-placed flow divider in the basilar artery. After this, patient was extubated on table in the cath lab, so there were no neurological deficits. She was kept in ICU for one day and shifted to ward. We did an MRI, check MRI after 2 days. So this was the check MRI. We can see these are the T1, T2 flare and DW images. So you can see this is the hyperintense structure in the anterior part of this aneurysm. This is the developing thrombus. So thrombus is forming within the aneurysm and there is no any evidence of coopetitor infarcts in the brainstem. This is MRI done after 2 days of the procedure. So patient was discharged on the postoperative day 3. She was suggested to continue dual antiplatelets and short course of steroids. So coming to the follow-up course, she came to OPD after 20 days. She was doing well with improvement of the previous symptoms and we suggested to continue dual antiplatelets. She came for DSA, check DSA after 3.5 months. So she was asymptomatic at the time of DSA. These are the follow-up DSA images done after 3.5 months of the post-procedure. These are the previous runs for comparison. This was the previous right vertebral run after putting a flow diverter. Now you see what has happened. This is the run from right vertebral in the after 3.5 months. You can see when previously aneurysm, both limbs of fasciculation, basilar artery and posterior circulation are filling. What has happened here is that there is a vascular remodeling has happened. The flow from the right vertebral artery is filling the left limb of the fenestration, basilar artery and posterior circulation. In this run, the aneurysm as well as the right limb of the fenestration are completely excluded from the circulation. And this is the lateral view. And other thing is happening is that both anterior inferior cerebral artery, which comes from the basilar artery, here as you can see, we don't see any branches here, but the right side branch is reforming from the right pica. That is called posterior inferior cerebral artery. So coming to the left vertebral run, what has happened? So previously this is the angiographic run from the left vertebral artery, which showed aneurysm, limbs of the fenestration, basilar artery and posterior circulation. Now see what has happened. This is the V4 segment of the right vertebral artery. It's filling the vertebro-basilar junction and going into the right limb of the fenestration and selectively opacifying the left ica. So here also, from this left vertebral run, aneurysm is excluded, left limb of the fenestration is not filling. So this is on the lateral view, you can see this was the flow diverter. There is a subtle filling of the basilar artery. So from this run also, aneurysm is completely excluded. So these were the DynaCT images of the follow-up scan. And these are the axial post-contrast CT images. Previously, this was the brightly filling aneurysm. Now the aneurysm is not filling, it's completely excluded from the circulation. So this is what in exactly the vascular remodeling which has happened in this case. We can see previously this was the scenario, two vertebral arteries, aneurysm and fenestration and both the branches of the basilar artery as well as right pica. So what has happened in the 3.5 months is almost a magic for us. So we never expected this to happen. So here see, we can see flow from the right vertebral artery has gone through the left vertebral artery into the basilar artery and everything is excluded from this side. From the right vertebral artery, from the left vertebral artery, only the right limb is filling and only the ICA, what the anterior inferior cerebral artery, is filling. So we have converted 6 inflow jets from aneurysm into 2 inflow jets and aneurysm thrombosis. This is in nutshell what has happened. So coming to the brief discussion. Coming to the development of the basilar artery, how it develops, this is the axial section of the neural tube at 3-4 weeks of embryonic life. This is the developing hindbrain. In front of this, you will get two embryonic paired longitudinal neural arteries. So they will fuse and form a basilar artery between the 4th to 5th week of embryonic life. When they fuse completely, this is what happens. You'll get a single lumen basilar artery with branches like this. So when they never fuse at all, it will lead to complete transfusion. So this will be like this. If they fuse partially and don't, in between if you something mishap happens, it will lead to fenestration. These fenestrations are common in the lower part of the vesicular artery below this ICA, very common below this ICA. Coming to the incidence, so reported incidence of this fenestration varies with which modality you are using to image. In on MRI, it has been reported to 1 to 2%. In postpartum studies, it has been reported up to 6% of the cases. Coming to the how, what is the fraction, what is the incidence of aneurysm in this fenestration? But there are very rare. To be fact, it's very rare. In aneurysms in the fenestrations are very rare. In short case series, it has been reported to very 7%. Why the aneurysm happens here is that because these fenestrated segments are structurally weak. Structurally weak, histopathologically, they were very deficient in the layers of the wall compared to the normal arteries. And coupled with this, we have an inflow jet from the both vertebral arteries. So it will lead to aneurysm formation in the proximal part of the fenestration. This is how aneurysm forms in the fenestration. So coming to the treatment options, there are surgery and endovascular. As I've already told, surgery is risky in this case, endovascular options are preferred. In endovascular group, when the neck of the aneurysm is narrow, we'll go for a simple and balloon-assisted coiling. Wide neck aneurysms, we prefer a stent-assisted coiling. So, and the flow diversion is now evolving technology. So there is very limited experience and if considered in the fenestration aneurysm. So this is how a flow diverter works. So flow diverter is nothing but a basic platform of a metallic stents, but with advanced features and deployment techniques. This is how the blood flows in a secular aneurysm, in a side branch secular aneurysm in an artery. This is where spiraling of blood happens in aneurysm. When we close a flow diverter like this, so the blood flow across the aneurysm will be stagnated and will divert the blood flow in a single channel when you place a flow diverter. So this stagnation leads to thrombosis of the aneurysm. Over a time, what happens is that layer of endothelium grows over the flow diverter. So aneurysm will be completely excluded from the circulation. This is how a flow diverter acts in vivo. Coming to the use of a flow diverter in the forced circulation, especially in the literature, there are a lot of uncertainties and mixed results because we'll get a lot of perforators which are not visible angiographically from the basilar artery. When you put these flow diverters have high metal coverage. When you place them in an artery, they will lead to perforator occlusions. Because of this, there is a lot of uncertainties and mixed results in the posterior circulation. When it comes to the fenestration aneurysms, in flow diverters in the fenestration aneurysms, there are a lot of technical issues because we don't know where to place, which limb to place. These all happens and size of the flow diverter also. There are a lot of technical issues and very limited experience in the literature. So here we also need to balance the risk of future rupture, because when you place a flow diverter, aneurysm will not get completely occluded immediately. It will take time. So that we need to balance the rupture risk as well as procedural complication. So the key here is proper patient selection and availability of skilled operators will definitely help to get optimal results. So far, to the best of our knowledge, this was the first case of a basilar artery fenestration aneurysm treated with a single flow diverter without any adjuvant coiling. When we reviewed the literature, we got only four reported cases. Both of them have used two flow diverters, as well as in one case there was a single flow diverter with using a coil. So this was the first case available in the literature. So to conclude, basilar artery fenestration aneurysms are rare and complex lesions. Endovascular treatment appears to be safe and efficient. Flow diverter stents may be considered a valid approach in these cases. The innovative approach used in this case shows what versatility of flow diverter technology, especially in atypical circumstances. So given the rarity of these aneurysms and the technique used, further studies are necessary to enhance our knowledge in this type of cases. Thank you.